can hear me, right?
Yes, I even hear myself.
Thank you so much for being here. We have a fantastic panel of people who are literally changing lives by getting them to start breaking a sweat. We're going to have a nice discussion here. I'm going to introduce each person as they begin to speak. I wanted to start first, though, by talking about the way that breaking a sweat changed my life. I think it's a little different from maybe a lot of you in here who came up as athletes or as people who had sports and fitness change their life very young. So the reason I'm here at LA84 is because I'm writing a book. I'm a historian. I don't know if there are any other historians here. This isn't my usual crowd. But I'm writing a book called Fit Nation, How America Embraced Exercise as the Government Abandoned It, about how we're a culture that really thinks exercise is good for you and kind of knows we should, but access to exercise has become not something that everybody has equal access to do. And how did that happen in the United States? But I came to that work actually through kind of a strange story. When I was really young, there were two options for a girl to be physically active. There were jocks and there were dancers. And to me, both of those things terrified me. I don't know what's happening. My hair, too much hair. Should have a ponytail.
I don't have that problem.
Sorry about that. The thought of dancing and going in the wrong direction, the thought of trying out for a team and not making it was so humiliating to me that I kind of backed away from those experiences. And at first, like, my parents were okay with that. I got good grades. We had no understanding or no language to talk about the way that working your body can actually develop your mind or develop you as a full person. Problem was, the longer that I backed away from those activities and only focused on school, the scarier it got. Such that I was so humiliated in PE class, the junior year of high school, this is like 1994, I couldn't face going back. I couldn't climb a rope. I couldn't run as fast as the other kids. I was always picked last. And so I looked up in my student rights and responsibilities manual, and what did I see there? You can do an independent study in gym. So I went to the head of the department, and they said, no one's ever asked us about this before. And I was like, it's in the book. And they said, okay, fine, let us come back to you. And they came back and said, well, you have to have a supervised activity. You can do personal training or group fitness. So I go to my parents, and they're like, we've heard of personal training. That's for rich people. Group fitness, we belong to a community center. You can go try that. And I was like, anything, not to go back to PE. Long story short, it was 1994. I found step aerobics. And it changed my life. I know it sounds cheesy now. But I'd never moved my body before. I'd never felt that I had kind of control over this body that as more than something that carried around my mind. And so I got really into it. And for the next 10 years, I kind of had this fitness passion on the side of my scholarly work. Fast forward, and I got certified to teach fitness in New York City about now almost 15 years ago. And I was hearing those same stories from the adults that I was teaching fitness to. And it was great. Yes, they were changing their bodies, but I got the courage to get divorced. I got the courage to ask for a new job. I got the courage to wear something that I was scared to do. And it was fantastic, but I realized, why are the only people that I'm engaging this work not my students at the university, not the kids at the public school next to the gym, but the people who can afford to be members of this fancy club? So from there, I founded a school-based program. I started this research program to figure out how we got where we are today. And I think, like so many people on here, the experience in relation to sports and fitness, although mine might be different, having never been an athlete, really shapes how this has all become, I know, my life's work and a lot of people up here. So what I want to do is plant a few big questions that encompass the work of this fantastic panel, and then invite them to answer whichever parts really speak to their work. So first, why is exercise so important to human overall thriving? Two, how is fitness and wellness so different, or maybe it's not, from sport? What's the school's role in youth fitness? What's the role of the private sector in creating opportunities? What's the biggest challenge each of you face in your work? Is it behavioral, structural, or otherwise? How do gender, ethnicity, class, and these other categories affect what you do in trying to accomplish play equity? And then, is there one story in your work that kind of encapsulates what we need to do or what you feel you're doing? So I'm going to turn it over first to Charles Hillman, a professor in my hometown of Boston at Northeastern University at the Center for Cognitive and Brain Health. So Chuck, tell us about yourself and what you do.
And thank you, Natalia.
Yeah.
I'd also like to thank Renata and her colleagues for inviting me out today. As an academic, I'm used to speaking in front of an audience with a slideshow and having an hour, so I'll speak quick in 6 minutes. And I have my notes. I think I'll probably tackle the first question on exercise and human thriving. And I'll remind you that we're victims of our own ingenuity. And what I mean by that is that we're comprised of the same genome that all of our ancestors have been comprised of for many, many generations. The problem is that this genome was built to support a physically active lifestyle. And most of us, in fact, the vast majority of us, don't engage in enough physical activity in order to support our genetics. And what that means is that we're in a state of metabolic dysfunction. We know this. We have an obesity crisis. It's now a pandemic. The problem is that not only are we not physically active, but we're also taking in too many calories. And so we have the issue of a metabolic imbalance. And much like the storage of excess body fat, this also has implications for brain and behavior. And so if we then turn to the brain and we focus on brain development, kids develop, their brains develop at a differential rate. That is to say that areas like the visual cortex develop very quickly, and so infants can see in the first year of life very easily and it's well developed. Other areas like the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus are areas that are involved in cognition and learning. These areas have protracted development, meaning that they take a long time to develop. In fact, we only have good prefrontal function in our 20s. So for those of us who are 30 and beyond, sad to say you're already decaying. I'm right there with you, so fear not. I'm not poking fun at you. The issue is that prefrontal cortex and hippocampus are areas that are involved in cognition, executive control, our ability to ignore distractions, stay focused, our ability to store items in our memory and use them at a later date, our ability to multitask. And in the case of hippocampus, this is where memory and learning take place. And so what the good news is that during childhood, we have a long time to affect these brain regions. And we can do this through physical activity. And so my work as a cognitive neuroscientist at the Center for Cognitive Brain Health at Northeastern University is all about finding areas where we can intervene. And what I'm talking about there is predominantly physical activity, also the management of healthy body weight. And so we do this a couple of different ways. We run interventions in kids, and some of those interventions are brief. They're simply 20 minutes. Others are longer. They're 9 months at a time. And the idea is that we look at how physical activity shapes the brain in terms of brain structure. We find differences in prefrontal cortex, hippocampus, as well as other regions. We find that these regions have greater volume when kids are more physically active. And we find that these regions also transmit information to each other in a more efficient fashion. We look at brain function, and there we're looking at how brain supports aspects of cognition like attention, processing speed, memory. And these are areas that are germane to scholastic performance, which we also study. And so the idea is that we look and see, are there ways to intervene in order to promote a healthier child in the classroom and therefore influence the context of learning? Jim Ball was kind enough to talk about my work a little bit. And he certainly is one of the many that I've been able to interact with that do a nice job of trying to intervene into schools, something that my laboratory doesn't do very well. But the idea is that we show that even in the case where we have children who are not physically active, it's hard to get them to be physically active, and this is true in adults as well, that even if people begin a physical activity or new curriculum, they don't stick with it. And so one of the things we're very interested in is how does short, brief bouts of exercise influence the brain for a temporary period of time? Are there transient effects on brain? And actually what we find is that the brain is actually very responsive to 20-minute bouts of walking. And so in kids, and there are also other areas as well, such as high-intensity interval training for a much briefer period of time, but the point is that there's plenty of room to intervene in the school day. And so I don't find that it's a satisfactory argument when teachers and administrators say there's really no time in the day for physical activity. There's no, we don't have money for specialized physical education instructors. That's just plain wrong. In fact, there should be time and money for that. But the fact of the matter is that there are things that you can do at your desk that will promote better brain function, better cognition, in support of learning and academic performance. And the basically the data suggests that 20 minutes of walking enhance processing speed, enhance attention, lead to more efficient brain function that supports inhibition, our ability to ignore distractions, stay focused, the ability to choose a correct response over a more dominant incorrect response. It supports working memory. It supports reading and math achievement. And so there is no reason why curriculum today doesn't build in 20-minute periods or even shorter if we want to do HIIT. I have colleagues in Australia that use HIIT intervention in order to show that that as brief as 8 minutes leads to better function following those interventions. And so I think I'll use the remainder of my time. Probably just one or
I'm not even waving my one-minute flag yet.
All right,
but yeah,
perfect. Oh, good, I'll go for hours. you know, I guess I think what's probably most important is for me to plug the Physical Activity Guidelines for Americans. I don't know how many of you are aware that the 2018 guidelines came out. I was fortunate enough to be one of the members of the Scientific Advisory Board where I learned an awful lot. But is anyone aware what the physical activity guidelines are for children these days? Yes, we don't do a very good job of marketing it.
Cold call them, Professor.
Yeah, I could pick someone out. So the guidelines are 60 minutes a day of moderate to vigorous physical activity every day of the week for children. In addition, they should have several days a week of bone and muscle loading activities. There, if you're at all interested and you want to know how to implement this, one thing that changed between 2008 and 2018 is they've done a better public campaign in that there's the Move Your Way campaign now that's geared towards kids. There's one for parents, there's one for teachers, and it goes across the lifespan. And so these are important things to know because a lot of people don't know where to start or how to start, and this takes all the guesswork out of it.
Yeah, good. Great.
I think I'll go ahead and stop there.
Okay, great. Yeah. Thank you so much. No, it's fantastic, and this research informs so much of the applied work that our fellow panelists are doing. So let me turn now, without further ado, to Carrie Wagner, who is the executive director of GALS Los Angeles. Carrie, take it away.
So first, I apologize that I was missing. I was so engaged in what was happening up here that I didn't realize I was supposed to be back getting my mic on. So I am found. I am here with you all, and I'm excited to be here. So GALS LA stands for the Girls Athletic Leadership School Los Angeles. So I founded that, and we're in our fourth year. And we're the first all-girls, a public charter middle school. So it's a free middle school for girls aged 11 to 14. And we empower girls to succeed academically, to live boldly, to lead confidently, and to thrive physically. And we lead with health and wellness as the key contributing factor to academic achievement. So what's so great about GALS is that every morning we start out and we work out together as a community. And so we have our math teachers down there, we have our science teachers down there, we have our English teachers down there. And they have a different title in the morning. It's called a wellness coach. And in many public schools right now, the PE ratio for the PE teacher and the students is like 45 to 70, I've seen. And our wellness teams are 15 to 1 because we're bringing everyone in to this program. And we're called the Girls Athletic School, but we're really a movement school. We believe that everyone is an athlete. We have several uniform shirts that are positive. The girls wear yoga pants or basketball shorts or jogging pants. They wear a GALS t-shirt. And one of the GALS t-shirts says, I am an athlete, because everyone is an athlete. And as you can imagine, our staff are all shapes and sizes. So for them to see their math instructor struggling with yoga, or to see their English teacher like not quite getting the hip hop steps right, it's really great for them because they see that they can do it as well. And what happens is we're all out there together, I'm out there with them, and when you sweat together, you kind of build this bond together. And by the time we get up to start our first class, our girls are happy, they are loud, they are not quiet as they're walking through those halls, and they're ready for their first class, so they can really absorb more, their brain can absorb more because they just did that activity. and we find that our attendance rates are really high. We find that there's joy out there. So I always encourage anyone to come visit us at any point, because it will really uplift your day, because these girls are laughing, they're cheering for one another. At this day and age, girls can kind of go two routes. They can go like the mean girl route, which I definitely experienced when I was in middle school, or they can go the sisterhood route. It's so easy for us women to get on the sisterhood route train. And when you teach that and really focus them on that, it's amazing what can happen to these girls. And we're pretty new in our school year. We're only 3 weeks in. So right now we're doing a running module. And we have girls that literally think they're having a heart attack, because they don't realize that, like, that's good for your heart to feel that way, because they've never been elevated like that before. So to me, it's just so exciting for them to know that not only is that, like, not scary, it's really cool. And for all of your classmates to be out there going really, really hard is great. And they do get graded on this morning movement, but they don't get graded by how well they do a burpee or how strong, or how many push-ups they can do. They get graded on their effort. So everybody's different. Sometimes push-ups might be hard for some people versus like squats or things like that. And we do lots of fun things, because for me, I feel like at middle school, you want to expose them to lots of different sports. So we have a spin room that we will hear about with in the future. And we also do track, we do wrestling, we do self-defense, we do hip hop, we do circuits. So we also do some organized sports in the morning. So they really get to try out lots of different things so that they are ready to go when they get to high school and know kind of what they want to do. The other thing that I think is really unique about GALS is we move all day. So we actually don't shower after we do our morning movement. We just keep going, because in English class, you're gonna move. And in math class, you're gonna move. And in science class, you're gonna move. It's really hard for anyone to sit still for 60 minutes. I mean, we're doing brain breaks here. Like, you guys just did one, I think, because I was back there listening. But it's like getting people moving, and it makes the girls want to be in school, and it makes them absorb more academically. I mean, you said 8 minutes. Our brain breaks are like 3 to 5 minutes, but we see amazing gains because they want to be in the classroom. Oh, I'm already up. Up soon. They want to be in the classroom, and they think school is fun because we're playing these games, but they're actually it's actually doing something for them. So the final thing I would say, especially I heard in the first panel, is they take a class a day. It's an hour a day called the GAL series. And in that class, they learn about how to be more compassionate to themselves and how to be more compassionate to others and how to have that growth mindset, how to get back up even when you don't feel strong about it. And then the last thing is, because the math teacher is out there, if his student is struggling with, let's say, fractions, and he saw his student struggling with like a burpee, for instance, or like learning those hip-hop choreography, and he sees them get over that, he has such an amazing data point to be like, it's the same thing with fractions. I saw what you could do with your body, and we can do the same thing with your mind. Let's do it. Let's go for it. So it's really great for the teachers to have that data and to also have that bonding experience with their students. So I definitely feel like this model is part of the solution.
I want hip hop with my fractions. My life could have been so different. It's amazing. I could say so much about it. But let me turn the mic over, proverbially turn it over, to Renato Paiva, who is the executive director of Access Youth Academy. Go
ahead.
Thank
you.
Yeah,
thank you. Good morning, everyone. I am Brazilian. I do have an accent, so I hope everyone can get that. I've been working for Access Youth Academy for 13 years, since the beginning. We're an after-school program that helps low-income students from San Diego, and we help them in two ways. Basically, one is through academics. We help them basically on the classroom. We also help them with the amazing sport of squash, which is not very well known in California. I keep always say that squash in California is like beach volleyball in Alaska. that's been my life. But we have a very interesting program. We have a 12-year promise where we get the students at the seventh grade, and we spend 12 years with them. So from seventh to 12th grade, we see them every day, where we spend 1 hour in the classroom, 1 hour in the squash courts. Then they go to college. Then we help them 4 years in college. Wherever they go, we support them in a different way. And then when they graduate from college, we spend 2 more years on the post-college helping them through grad school or their first job. We believe that that's the whole insurance that we need to make sure that the whole process, the whole cycle comes through. We've been very lucky in our 13 years. We have 100% graduation rate from high school to college. We have, we yield $7.4 million in scholarships to the best colleges in the country. And we, in the process, and although it's not the priority, we've won 13 national titles. So that's pretty cool. Our kids have gone to schools like a couple of Ivies, UCLA, USC, and a bunch of others, so we're very happy with that. I do want to talk about why squash. I am from Brazil, from Sao Paulo, and I play squash. Could have been anything, could have been ballet, could have been chess, could have been any sport. Squash is a great angle because if you want to have an in to go to college, as you probably might know, the niche sports are an easy way to get in. So squash is, we do that. But also is a one-on-one sport that you can hide. Just like a boxing ring or an MMA octagon or a squash court, you close the door behind you and it doesn't matter where you're from, your size, your color, you gotta play. If you haven't played squash before, it's very competitive. So it's very interesting. And you can win with your power or with your brain, which a lesson that we teach them often is if you don't want to overpower someone, think it through, you might have a win to win the game. I want to talk a little bit about the equity part. I was lucky enough to be from a rich family in Brazil and I could play squash. My dad paid my way through. And I was, prior to this job, I was coaching at Harvard. And at some point, when I bused back from Yale, I realized, what am I doing? This is not it. I don't want to just win a title. That's not what I'm doing. So I moved to San Diego and I started Access Youth Academy. And the whole idea is to really teach them life skills through sports, which is the theme that everyone thinks thinking about this. And it's, I believe we are winning. We're winning this battle of getting the kids to become better people in this world through sports. One of the secrets of our sauce is the tryout process. So are we looking for the best athletes? Are we looking for the kids with the best grades when we come in seventh grade? The answer is no and no. Doing tryouts, the 2 month period of tryout. This last tryout, we had 100 kids trying out for 10 spots, and that happens every year. We are looking for things like grit, dedication, commitment to the program for 12 years. We're looking for things like this. We don't know their grades. We don't know their documentation legally in the country. We know nothing about them. And it's funny enough, we care less if they can hit a ball or not. Funny story is this, when I go to gym classes to say, hey, I'm Renato, I have an accent, and this is, who wants to go to college? All the hands go up. Who knows what squash is? All the hands go down. And then that's when we start thinking, he's a racket, and let me show you this. And then after the gym session, I invite them for the first tryout. It takes a few weeks. They're doing tryouts, so we select kids that have all those qualities of being polite and being like to work in a group. And so then after this whole 4 weeks, we select them to the 10, and then I go do home visits. If the family is not on board with us, it's not going to work. So we've had some great home visits and some horrible ones where I said, I don't think it's a good fit, and some home visit that it was a perfect fit. And then they start with us, and the whole 12-year promise starts. I just want to, before you wave the little flag on me, I want to just say that a quick story. My original cohort, we had a kid from City Heights in San Diego. So if you know San Diego a little bit, City Heights is a place that's not very affluent. Her name is Reina Pacheco. And Reina was a gang member, and she was about to be expelled from her school. The week she spat in the teacher's face, the week that I got her, so she's not doing too well. I loved her. Her leadership, funny enough, her leadership through the negative aspect kind of caught my attention. We got her. She loved the game. She trained really hard. She was not talented at all. She could not bounce a basketball at all. But we loved her. She loved the game. She put a lot of effort into it. She won 9 national titles in the years with us, 5 team as a captain and 4 individuals. She went to Columbia at a Gates Millennium Scholarship.
Wow.
There's more. She ended up going to Columbia, playing number 1 on the team, became the first professional squash player. There is a professional tour. Professional squash player where she traveled the world. And the last year, she decided to go to make some money. Now she worked in Goldman Sachs and doing great stuff. So that's that.
That's amazing. I think so many people think there's a tension between being inclusive and being competitive, but I love the way that story and your whole program suggests you don't have to choose, right? So let us turn to last but certainly not least, Matthew Fleesock, who is the executive director of UCLA Health Sound Body, Sound Mind.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here. So I oversee an organization called Sound Body, Sound Mind, and our mission is to promote self-confidence and healthy lifestyle choices among today's youth. And the way that we do that is by focusing specifically on the physical education space in school. We believe, as an organization, I believe it with every bone in my body, that physical education is the most important subject a student has. It should be treated and funded as well as math, English, history, and science. Oh yeah, thank you. I really believe this. But what we're facing today is a massive lack of resources. And that's what our organization has stepped in and done. We have a 3-part program. We provide middle schools and high schools, particularly in low-income areas here in Los Angeles, with state-of-the-art fitness centers. The students at Gals actually have access to one of our fitness centers that was installed in 2018. We provide fitness accessories. We have a classroom curriculum that is fitness-based, it's circuit-based, but more importantly, it's focused on creating a positive, safe, welcoming classroom environment, because as many people who have negative perceptions of physical education class will say, they just didn't feel comfortable. And what we're striving to do is create that comfortable environment, because that's where a student will be exposed to countless activities, sports included, potentially find their activity, and if it's a safe environment, they're gonna feel confident, their competence is gonna grow. When their competence grows, their confidence increases. When you're more confident, your competence grows, and it just positively feeds itself. Our organization, we're in 137 schools here in Los Angeles. We're across 6 school districts, including Compton and Long Beach, but our primary impact is in the Los Angeles Unified School District. We have been around for 21 years, and in that time impacted over 750,000 students. What I want to highlight is the role that schools play, particularly in providing equitable opportunities for fitness. Fitness is an umbrella term. Sports are part of it in physical education. But what we're seeing is schools are so under-resourced and underfunded. Their PE class ratios, as you heard, are extreme. It used to be 70. They capped it at 55. Now, the LAUSD strike, people were fighting for 35-35. Was PE part of that? Absolutely not. So we have these massive classes. And I remember being in PE, walking into the football weight room, which was all my school had, going, no, no. And I wasn't the only one. And so what we're here trying to do is provide these resources where, particularly in low-income communities, they're lacking. If you look across South Los Angeles or you look across East Los Angeles, you won't find an Equinox, you won't find a 24-hour fitness, you won't find an LA Fitness, you might find a Planet Fitness, and you might find some small mom-and-pop gyms. But you know what? Gyms and using fitness equipment is a life skill that every single student, every single person needs. And these communities are stripping students of that opportunity. And so schools, as you heard, are where every child is. Physical education class, every single middle school student will take PE. Every single student. What a captive audience that is. And that is the age where students are malleable. They're gonna develop new fitness habits. They're gonna develop these lifelong habits. They're gonna find their passions. And so we need to be looking at that space and investing in it, providing that opportunity to those gyms, because if you don't see it at an early age, you're gonna be intimidated when you walk in, you're gonna cast it aside. And the research shows that fitness as a young person leads to fitness as an adult. It is a just known trend The research is there on why PE is so important. We heard about some of the academic benefits, their social emotional benefits. Physical education class, when introducing you to sports, introduces you to character traits that are tremendously important to just being a good person. Everyone that has played a sport knows that the resilience you learn, the appropriate competitive spirit, the teamwork, the industrialness, those are things that make people truly, truly shine, and those are things that are taught in physical education. I know we're at a sports-focused event. I do play sports once a week to stay fit, but the majority of my adult fitness comes from a gym, and gyms can be introduced in physical education. And so it's so critically important that we're looking at schools as the ripest venue, the low-hanging fruit for reaching our children at that right age. And when we're providing those resources, we're able to really introduce them to things that normally they wouldn't have a benefit and exposure to. And I'll stop there so we can hear from you guys.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, this like not just more PE, but what do we do in PE is so crucial. I think you make that point beautifully. So we have a couple minutes to hear from you. What would you like to know? And we'll be circulating throughout the lunch and afternoon. Anybody?
We could keep talking.
You gotta. Really?
I don't buy it.
I don't believe it. All right, let me ask one question then. Fine. So what do we need to do? What's the next step? Is it a policy change? Is it, you know, industry change and industry priorities? Is it, you tell me. Oh, the floor is open. Yeah. Any of you? Go ahead.
Yeah, so one of the things I was fortunate to do is work, was to serve a committee at the Institute of Medicine. Mm-hmm. And one of the key points that came out of it was that schools that with kids needing to spend 60 minutes a day of moderate to vigorous physical activity, that school should be accountable for at least 30 of those minutes every single day of the week. Mm. And I'll stop there and move down the line.
Yeah, and I just really believe integration, like getting everyone involved in movement at the school is the way to really make it part of like a behavior and just a health and wellness routine.
I just want to make a quick comment on this, that back home, the more money you have, the less sports you play. So back home, if you don't have any money, you're playing sports all day. And here, often I see the opposite. So part of my work is to make this gap better, but I just want to kind of highlight this to this audience so full of Americans.
Yeah.
That's interesting to see this.
But why is that? Because sports is considered lowbrow, or what's...
No, sports is just part of what we do.
But in Brazil, why would that not be considered a luxury or a privilege?
Don't know the answer for that.
You can't do it in 80 seconds? Yeah.
Yeah.
I would just, if I could wave my magic wand that I don't have, I would make it so physical education is offered for every student, for every grade level. Here in California, you stop taking PE after 10th grade. 11th grade students don't magically not need 60 minutes of activity anymore. And in these low-income areas, their neighborhoods may not be safe. There may not be a park within walking distance. There's lack of access to healthy food options, which I won't even start because that's a whole different summit topic. Schools need to step up. In some states, you can take online physical education class. I'm not making that up. There are multiple states where you're like, oh yeah, I'm just gonna sit at a computer and take PE. And so I think we need to look to close these loopholes and ensure that every student in school is given the venue and opportunity to be active.
Yeah, I think that fitness is a life skill, and that even if you have a gym nearby and you happen to be able to afford it and you have the time to, you have to know why you would want to use it, right? That's a really good note to close on, I think. So thank you to all of you and all of you for being here, and let's work out.